And just to say thank you very much for welcoming me today to speak on this topic. And just to say, I'm always really impressed when I come into the upper room to see the work that you do as part of serving people who are vulnerable in this part of London. It's a really valuable work that you do in all kinds of ways, and I'm really proud to be involved with the upper room as a patron of the charity as well. Tonight, the theme, as Julian was saying when we began thinking about this, we thought about giving a lecture on Luther. It's my academic specialism. I've done a lot of work on Martin Luther. That was last year's topic, really, with the Reformation 500th anniversary. So, and obviously with Grenfell Tower happening in between, the idea was to talk a bit about this. So I want to talk firstly about my own experiences of being involved with the Grenfell Tower fire at the time and since. And then go on to with some reflections about what it says to us as a society and how we begin to deal with some of the issues raised by what happened at Grenfell Tower. Here's the story. My involvement begins on the morning of the fire itself. As you know, it was the 14th of June last year. We were waking up around 6 o'clock in the morning, which is the time I normally wake up at home, looking at my phone and seeing there was a tweet from a radio station asking would I give a comment on the fire. And of course I thought, what fire? Immediately went onto the internet and began to realise that something significant had happened. I then had to work out exactly where it was, and literally work out, is this in one of our parishes, one of the parishes that I'm responsible for. I very quickly worked out that it was in the parish of St. Clements, and I knew the vicar there, Alan Everett, and so I rang him on the phone, trying to get hold of him, and found it difficult to get hold of him to begin with, and eventually got him on the phone to find out the story so far. This was around 7:30 in the morning, and I discovered that he had been up since 3 o'clock in the morning. What happened was that one of the other clergy, Sean Doherty, who helps at St. Francis, had gone away around the corner, who lives just opposite the fire, had been woken up around 2 or 3 in the morning, literally by helicopters and by noise and shouting and screaming outside, and opened his window to see the tower on fire. So he went round to Alan's house and knocked on his door and said, come on, we've got to do something. And they both went together to St. Clements and they opened the doors at 3 o'clock in the morning, and people began to fill the church from that moment onwards. So I heard this story and said, right, I'm coming straight away. It's one of those moments when somehow instinct kicks in, you don't quite know what to do, no one quite prepares you for anything like this. But I realised that I basically had to cancel everything that day and to head up to North Kensington. So I took a train from Twickenham, where we lived, to get up to near the place. Of course, there were a lot of police around. The tube station wasn't working, going up to Latimer Road. And so I had to get a taxi to get me as near as I could, get out of the taxi, walk the last piece of the journey. And of course, on the way there, I got on the train, thinking, right, I must be there and try to support Alan and the local church and see what they were doing. And then, of course, wondered to myself, what am I actually going to do when I get there? Am I going to be any use to anyone? Now, what happened was that I got an email on the way up from the chaplain to the Metropolitan Police, putting me in touch with the local borough commander, Ellie O'Connor, who was in charge of the police operation around Grenfell Tower. And so I rang her up on the way there and said, look, I'm on my way to the tower, is there anything I can do? And she said, well, actually there is, as it happens, because we have firefighters going in and out of the building, and they're having to do and to see some fairly traumatic things, and it's really quite a difficult thing for them. It would be wonderful if there were just a few people around to be able to talk to them as they go in and out and do the work that they have to do. So I said, yes, I'll do whatever I can. Rang around a couple of local clergy to get them to come. And so when I arrived at the tower was smoking. You can see the smoke going into the air. We went up to the cordon. Of course, there was a cordon around the tower beyond which the public couldn't go. Any of the emergency services were allowed. I was wearing my purple shirt, as you might remember. It was a really hot day, and purple shirts on my open doors that other colour shirts don't somehow. And so I spoke to the police on the cordon and said, the borough commander's asked if we could go in and help out inside the cordon. And so they allowed us in. I think we were the only sort of civilians, non-emergency service people allowed into that central cordon around the tower on the morning of the fire. And so I spent most of the morning in there at that place. These are a couple of pictures I took on that morning where the firefighters were around. You can see the tower just burning there every now and again, a little flat, and catch fire and flames would burst out of it. And firefighters were going in. They were only able to spend 20 minutes to half an hour inside the building at any one time because it was just too hot. And it was very difficult for them to get up to the upper levels of the tower itself. And there was a real fear at the time because, as you can see on this picture here, one of the problems that fire service had at the time was that this was the tallest kind of crane they could get to pour water onto the fire. This wasn't even a London fire brigade appliance. It was something they had to borrow from, I think it was a Surrey fire brigade. So this was basically as high as they could go in terms of getting water onto the fire, which was fairly small when you think of the extent of the damage. And of course, what they were having to do was to go in, and their priority was to try to get people who were alive. And of course, they were then having to step over bodies of people who were dying on the stairwells, children, adults. It was a fairly, really, really difficult thing to do. Many of them said that in 30, 40 years of being in the fire service, there wasn't anything remotely like this at all. And so we were just able to talk with them, just to help them debrief a little bit, just to kind of reassure them that the rest of the world valued massively what they were having to do and sacrifice on that day. So I spent half the morning here with the firefighters going in when we gathered enough clergy to be able to be around to talk with the emergency service people. Of course, the ambulance service were there, the police as well. I then left them there and spent some time back at St. Clement's Church. When I went back to St. Clement's Church, which is the parish church, which is literally only 300 yards away from Grenfell Tower. Already by that stage, when I first went in there, it was around about 9 o'clock in the morning. The place was beginning to fill up. It was already full of people. It was full of people in their pyjamas, people who were still looking very dazed. Many of them had either come out of the tower itself or out of the surrounding walkways, because of course the surrounding blocks had been evacuated as well overnight. And literally people had got out of bed and were sitting there. I remember talking to a family with an elderly lady who was very anxious because she was on all kinds of medication. She had to leave her tablets in her flat. She was not allowed back in again. She was worried what was going to happen because she couldn't take her tablets. Could she get to a chemist? And that was the kind of ordinary kind of issue that people were facing. And being in this place of real trauma, of real shock, of people just trying to process what on earth had just happened. And wondering what on earth you can say. And of course, there's not much you can say at that time. But I was able to pray with one or two of the people who were there. One thing we could offer is, one thing I can do is to pray for people, and people were often very welcoming at that offer. Very soon the building began to fill not just with people, but also with donations. We started having food, nappies, water bottles, clothing, donated from all over. It was a slightly bizarre sight because, of course, many of the items that had been given were from the sort of rather posher end of Kensington further down. And you could tell some people had gone into their wardrobe and grabbed up whatever they could and bought sequin dresses and sparkly shoes and all these kind of things, which weren't really going to be much use to people at the time. That became a real bit of a problem locally because, of course, far more was given than was really needed in terms of the number of people who actually needed help. And it wasn't a cold time of year, people were bringing blankets, but actually blankets was the last thing you really needed on June the 14th last year. It was one of the hottest days of the year, but this extraordinary generosity came about. So that was one of the things, I think, in those few days, that we saw this extraordinary moment in the life of our city, where suddenly we all lost our fear of each other. You know, there's that fear that we have of people who look different and sound different and come from a different sort of ethnic background or social background or whatever, and somehow that for a couple of days just disappeared. And everybody flocked to try to see what they could do to help. People were bringing cases of clothes from elsewhere in the country just to come and do what they could. People locally were coming out to see what they could do. I remember taking this picture at one point during the outside one of our churches, and it was a church that was trying to kind of set up some beds and some relief centres. remember snapping this picture. What struck me about it was the sheer incredible variety of people who were in that picture. There's just about every ethnicity you can think of, pretty well every religion you can think of. Here were people trying to do what they could to help, no matter who they were. It wasn't all Christians or Muslims or secular people or atheists or whatever, it was everybody. Somehow sensing that deep common humanity that we all have that brings you out to try to do something to help in a moment like that. And that picture for me just captured that moment, if you like, of a city that suddenly we lost our fear of each other and we reached out to try and see what we could do to help in the situation. So that was what the first few days were like. What happened on the Friday morning of the week, the fire happened, as you know, on a Wednesday morning. On the Friday morning, I got a phone call from number 10 Downing Street, which was the Prime Minister's Faith's advisor. You might remember that the Prime Minister had made a visit to the site of the tower, but had received a fair bit of criticism for that because she had only seen emergency services and hadn't engaged with the local community. I guess she had some security advice that it wasn't safe to do that, and so she followed that advice and just talked to emergency services. And that had gone down well within the local community. And I think probably number 10 realised that something needed to be done differently. So I was asked, could I bring together a group of local people for the Prime Minister to meet with them and to hear some of their concerns. And so I said, well, anything we can do to help, we're happy to do that. Consultation with the local church in Clements, we managed to gather together a group of around 15 people, various ages, genders, religions, backgrounds, was who survivors from the tower itself, evacuees from the local blocks, and volunteers, people from the church, people from the local mosque. This gathering met with the Prime Minister in St. Clement's Church on that Friday afternoon. It was meant to last around about an hour and a half, the meeting, but 45 minutes in, I got a whisper in the ear from one of the security people, basically saying that a bit of a situation was developing outside, and people had seen the Prime Minister coming in, and there was a crowd gathering outside, and everybody angry, there was shouting going on, and they said, we need to get the Prime Minister away, so we need to bring this to a close. Someone said at the end of the meeting, this is a shame, it's still going, and so the Prime Minister said, well, I would like to continue this conversation, so she was spirited away. We got a call later on that evening to say that the Prime Minister would like to invite us to 10 Downing Street the day after. So we all were taken and went to 10 Downing Street to meet with the Prime Minister. And one of those strange moments in life you have to suddenly pinch yourself, because I found myself in the cabinet room, sitting in this seat with the Prime Minister next to me, chairing this meeting, not with the cabinet, but with this extraordinary varied group of people, from a 10-year-old girl a 70-year-old granny, people of all kind of faiths and backgrounds, angry teenagers who were really angry at what had happened, unmeasured elderly people, people with all kinds of different perspectives, all gathered there to tell the Prime Minister what they thought. And trying to manage that, both of those meetings, my job was to try to hold the meeting together, to try to say, yes, there's a lot of anger around in the meeting, but in a sense, to say we don't want to crush that, and it needs to be expressed, but it needs to be expressed in a way that's constructive, that allows the Prime Minister to hear the concerns of local people. I think looking back, you know, it was done very hastily, probably pretty good, got a different group of people together, I don't know. I think at the time it enabled the Prime Minister to hear one or two of the local concerns and opened a bit of a dialogue which happened in a number of other ways going on from there as well. So the other thing we did on those early days was to put together a service on Friday evening. We realised quite early on needed to somehow process the shock of what had happened, the range of emotions, the shock and the anger and in a sense the pride of the community response of all that had emerged. So we arranged the service at St. Peter's Notting Hill, just a mile or so away from the tower, which was an extraordinarily profound, tragic, sad, reflective, remarkable service where many people in the community came together just to be able to sort of sit and think and pray and listen. There was music, there were prayers, there were readings. It was just a chance, something just to stop the frantic activity. The other thing that I got involved in those early days was the media piece. What happens in one of these dramatic occasions like this is the 24/7 media beast from around the world descends upon a place, and that's exactly what happened. And very soon, from the first day one, the place was absolutely filled with media people, and radio stations, TV stations, all wanting something of the story. And obviously, as a relatively prominent local faith leader, a lot of people wanted to speak to me and to other clergy who were around as well. So I ended up giving quite a lot of interviews to press all around the world. I think it was Italian TV, Finnish, German, Spanish, American, British, just about every country you can imagine. And you would go to a particular place, give an interview to one thing, and you were arranged to give an interview. And then, of course, four or five other journalists would be queuing up, so we have a little word as well. And so, again, that was quite a tricky thing to do, trying to get that right, because especially after the meeting with the Prime Minister, there was a lot of media interest in what happened there, and trying to report back on that in a way that didn't betray confidences, but actually portray to the wider community some of the feelings of local people was a tricky thing to do. So trying to navigate that was all part of the story as well. So that was the time itself of the fire. I guess pretty soon after that, I also realised that one of the important things that needed to happen here, lots of other things going on, lots of charities getting involved in offering help within the community, but I kind of realised that one of the things that needed to happen was some form of way for the community to come together to remember those who had died and to mark the significance of this event for them. And so I developed a relationship with Grenfell United, which is one of the primary groups that represents survivors from the tower itself. And in a meeting with Shaheen Sadafi, who's the chair of Grenfell United, we began to talk about what would be appropriate. And I said, look, we can do something in Loftus Road, QPR ground, you can do something in, there'd been this game for Grenfell in the summer, you can do something in the Royal Albert Hall, and you could do something in St Paul's Cathedral. If that's what you'd like to do, I'd be very happy to try and see what I can do to make that happen. And he said, and when he talked to the Grenfell United Committee and others around, very much St Paul's Cathedral is what we want to do. And we shared that idea with other groups that are kind of interested and involved in representing the local community. And everyone was pretty united that that's what they wanted. Not to wait for a year, but the 6-month anniversary was going to be a key moment for that. So I went to St Paul's Cathedral and said to them, the local community would love to have something on December the 14th, 6-month anniversary in St Paul's Cathedral to remember remember what happened. And would that be possible? They said, well, any other day would be fine. We've got a carol service that evening. Really not a great day for us. He said, well, that is really the day that will happen. And so, good on St Paul's Cathedral. They said, yes, okay, we'll do it. And so we planned the service. And getting there from that moment until the service itself was quite something, because there are many different groups representing various different people that don't always see eye to eye, keeping everybody on board and making sure that as far as possible this was a service where many people could come together to remember those who had died, to celebrate the community that had come together and the reality and importance of community, but also to offer some kind of hope for the future. Those were the themes we decided on together. Getting everyone to that point was not an easy thing. Trying to deal with the kind of multi-faith aspect of it, because many people who died were Muslims. But it was a Christian cathedral. Within a Christian cathedral, Anna Moore says that we can only say Christian prayers. So how do we include the Muslim contribution? We managed to do that through a lovely Muslim girls choir from a Muslim school locally who sang a really beautiful song as part of that. And I think St Paul's Cathedral did a wonderful job of putting together a very extraordinarily moving service. And some of you will watch that on TV, some of you may have been there at the time. I had the privilege and the task of speaking into that situation and giving a brief reflection as part of it. And I think that has proved one of the moments that were very significant for the local community, where people could come together. It was one of the first times that people from the tower actually did see each other again, because on the night of the fire they were scattered. And many of them hadn't seen each other until that day when they all came together in St Paul's 6 months later. So that's been my own personal involvement. Very happy to answer any more questions about that a little bit later on as we go along. But I wanted to Grenfell has raised for us as a society. Back in November of 2017, that last year, you may remember that Bishop James Jones, who was the Bishop of Liverpool, who was very involved in the Hillsborough disaster and the aftermath of that, and has been involved with the families at Hillsborough for many years since that occasion, produced a report at the request of the government on the experience of the Hillsborough families and what was to be learned from their experience. And he gave the title of his report, and his title of his report, I think, was not quite what the government expected. They probably expected a nice neutral title like Report on the Hillsborough Family Experience. And the title he gave this report was The Patronising Disposition of Unaccountable Power. That's provocative, isn't it? Patronising Disposition of Unaccountable Power. And the subtitle was, this was a report to ensure the pain and suffering of the Hillsborough families is not repeated. And in that report, he said this: what this report describes as a patronising disposition is a cultural condition, a mindset which defines how organisations and people within them behave, and which can act as an unwritten, even unspoken connection between individuals and organisations. One of its core features is an instinctive prioritisation of the reputation of an organisation over the citizens' right to expect people to be held to account for their actions. This represents a barrier to real accountability. What he was trying to put his finger on there, in terms of the Hillsborough families and what they had experienced in the response they had from the police, from the legal system, all the way through their fight for justice for the 96 victims of the Hillsborough disaster, was this tendency of institutions that sometimes feel threatened because a disaster happens on their watch, on their patch, as it were, to close ranks and to seek to defend the institution rather than do the counterintuitive thing, which is actually to not worry about the institution's reputation and instead give itself to the people who really need help and who are affected by the disaster. And I guess this has also affected even more so since Hillsborough, because of the ubiquity of social media and the kind of public perception of things. And in our world these days, sometimes it can seem more important to look good as to be good. And so that temptation is there for all of us. And managing public perceptions sometimes can seem as important as doing the right thing. And we have all kinds of PR people telling us, you can't do this because it wouldn't look good, or you can't do that because it wouldn't look good, or whatever it might be. And that sometimes complicates matters. Now that report of Bishop James Jones, from my conversations around the North Kensington area, has really struck a chord with many people, many families who are there with them affected by the disaster, many of the organisations that have been part of the GLEE community of North Kensington, Lancaster West and so on. Because of course this fire did not just happen in a vacuum. It came into a situation where there was a feeling amongst many people in North Kensington that their area was being gradually gentrified without their consent. There was a feeling, rightly or wrongly, that much of the social housing in that part of London was gently being neglected and not being looked after properly, with the hope that people in that area would gradually move out and move into other areas so that the buildings could be either knocked down or redeveloped, for more expensive houses to be put up that could then be sold to developers and sold to foreign people who buy and invest in London properties. And that was basically the plan behind it. Now that was rightly or wrongly the suspicion that many people had in the area. Tenant Management Organisation, TMO, which managed Grenfell Tower and many of the properties in that area, was not a popular body, you can say it that way. One of the things that struck me during those meetings with the Prime Minister and these local residents was that two of the things they were saying, this was literally 2 days after the fire, two most important messages they gave to the Prime Minister on those 2 days was, number one, a fund of 5 million, an emergency fund of 5 million to get set aside for the families, and the intention that the government had was to give it to the council, RBKC, to the minister, and the people in the local area said, do not do that. Do not give it to RBKC, give it to someone else. And as a result of our meetings, it was channeled instead through, I think, through the DWP and through the post office rather than RVKC, because RVKC was not trusted within the local community. And the other thing that was a very loud voice within those meetings was disband the TMO. The tenant management organisation is not trusted. It has been negligent in the way it's handled the building and so on. We do not trust the TMO. It has to be taken off the case straight away. Now again, I'm not making a judgment whether that's right or wrong. I'd say that was a very strong message from the community to the Prime Minister at that time. It sort of alerted me to this situation into which the fire happened. It was already happening in a place where trust in authority and trust in government, local government and national government was very low. Where there wasn't that sense of trust that these are people who are on our side working for us, but instead a feeling within that part of North Kensington that these are not people on our side at all. And so this is the situation into which it came. You will know how warnings have been given about the refurbishment of the tower, the infamous cladding around it that had been put up, £10 million project to put cladding around it, how safe that was. The lack of sprinkler systems within the building itself. Concerns have been raised by the Grenfell Action Group about some of the safety concerns about the redevelopment and how it happened. There was this feeling that the building was meant to be look good by putting cladding on the outside to make it look good alongside the local academy and sports centre that had been set up, rather than actually seeking to look after the safety of residents. Again, quite normally that was the perception that was there. And there was, I think, this anger that came out in the early days. There was both shock and anger. I think that anger emerged from a sense that people felt, I think, in that local community, they didn't really have much control over their lives. Decisions were being taken about their lives and their housing and their community that they didn't really have any real say. But whenever consultation happened, it felt like it was just a decision that had already been taken, or knew what was going to happen. But consultation was a bit of a fig leaf, it was just something you had to do, and it wasn't really going to make any difference. That was the feeling that local people had. And when you have people who feel that they are not consulted, they're not involved in decisions, and same with all of us, you know, if any of us felt that decisions were being made about our house, our community, and our lives, that we had no say in whatsoever, that we actually were serving another agenda, we would feel aggrieved, we would feel angry, we would feel not treated with the dignity that we are worth as human beings. And that's, I think, what sort of sparked off what emerged in those early days. And anger, of course, when anger is expressed, that leads to fear. When someone's angry with you, you tend to kind of shrivel up inside. That's what a little bit happened within RVKC, and that leads to more of a standoff, and then the cycle continues. And I remember at the time of the service in St Paul's Cathedral in December. As I said, I had the opportunity and the responsibility to try and speak into that situation. But I remember saying something at the end of that service, which actually the Evening Standard picked up and put on the front page of the Evening Standard that night. And what I said at that point was this, that my hope, my prayer, is that today we will pledge ourselves to change from a city where we didn't listen, but we didn't hear the cries of our neighbours because we were too wrapped up in our own interests and prosperity, to create a new type of life together where we are turned not inwards towards ourselves but outwards towards each other. The society known for listening, compassion and love. In years to come, our hope is that the name of Grenfell will not just be known as a symbol of sorrow, grief or injustice, but as a symbol of the time that we learnt a new and better way to listen and to love. And I guess in that, I was trying to say, well, the possibility, the opportunity we have out of the tragedy of Grenfell actually is to really go deep and to learn a different way of living together, which is why this title of this talk, Living Together After Grenfell, is so appropriate. And I just wanted, just in for a few minutes, to explore what that might look like. Now, there are all kinds of political questions around this. There are technical questions around it, which of course the inquiry is looking into at the moment, and until the inquiry produces its report, we don't know. We hope that the inquiry will get to the bottom of what caused the fire, who was responsible, if there is blame to be allocated, where that is to be allocated. So there is the technical questions, there are political questions around, and the political football of Grenfell is tossed to and fro. Again, rightly or wrongly, there are some people jumping on the bandwagon of Grenfell and trying to use it for other purposes. And it's a bit of a minefield to try to work that out. I'm not a politician. I'm a bishop. I'm a Christian. And so I guess my approach to this is trying to see what does the Christian faith have to bring to this question of living together after Grenfell. And as I do that, my mind turns to, if you like, not so much spirit, because I think there is a spiritual dimension to this issue, as well as a political and a technical one at the same time, which is to do with the way we relate to one another. And so I wanted to spend a bit of time just thinking about, or at least my mind turned to, what are the great iconic stories of Western culture, really? Something that everyone knows about, even if they don't know the details of the story. It is, of course, the story that Jesus told, which we know of as the story of the prodigal, of the Good Samaritan. And in terms of culture change, what would it mean to change our culture, our way of living together? I wonder whether this story has something to say to us. Let me remind you of how the story is introduced. Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, Jesus said to him, "You've given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" And then, of course, Jesus goes on to tell the story of the Good Samaritan, this man who is beaten up and laid by the side of the road between Jerusalem and Jericho, and the priest and the Levite come by and they ignore him, they pass by on the other side, and then the Samaritan, the last person you would expect to stop and help a Jewish victim of crime, actually does exactly that. He stops, he bends down, he bandages his wounds, put him on his donkey, takes him to the inn, puts him in, offers to pay whatever it takes to get him better again, sees it through to the end, and there is the story that Jesus tells. Now, we all know that story, and I want to draw one or two things out of it that I think shed light on life living together after Grenfell. I think the first is simply the beginning of this story, which highlights what Jesus says again and again in his ministry. What are the two purposes of human life? When he's asked the question, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" he puts the question back in this man's court. At other points in the story, in the ministry of Jesus, he's also asked the question, "What is the greatest commandment?" And he replies the same way every time. He says there are two great commandments. There are two purposes to human life. One is to love God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and strength. The other is to love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. When the man says this, Jesus says, "You're right, you've absolutely got it right. This is the answer to this conundrum of the purpose of human life." And in those two things, then we can say this. The first is to love God, which in other words is to realize that we need this relationship with our Creator, the one who gives us everything we have. I think that command to love God is all about living a life of gratitude. It's living a life where you recognize, or we recognize, everything we have comes to us as a gift, not something we own or deserve. That instinct to give thanks is deeply rooted in all of us. We want to give thanks to someone. Even if we don't believe in a God somehow, we feel the need to give thanks to someone. And it is crucial, we know, to cultivate a sense of gratitude and thankfulness in life. Grateful people are usually happy people. Ungrateful people are usually unhappy people. If you meet someone who in a sense thinks that everything they have is their own and they deserve it, it comes from them because I'm a rather good person, I deserve this. They tend to look down on other people thinking, well, they didn't deserve it. Maybe they're lazy, maybe they're bad, maybe they're inadequate, that's why they haven't received all these things. Instead, someone who is grateful, who recognizes that actually everything they have is a gift, is less likely to look down upon other people as somehow unworthy. And it seems to me that's the beginning of the patronizing disposition of unaccountable power. It's a lack of gratitude. It's that sense that I have these things because I somehow deserve them, because I earn them, and you haven't got these things because you didn't deserve them, you didn't earn them. You're not as good as me. That's where that patronizing position begins to come from. If instead I begin to realize that the things that I possess actually are not mine, they're given to me as a gift, I'm much less likely to be patronizing towards someone else than if I think they are my own things. So that seems to me is what learning to love God means. It means learning to love the one who gives everything that we have. And the second one, of course, is loving our neighbor. Now, this sounds very obvious, doesn't it? Love your neighbor. We hear that phrase again and again. We think it's a very obvious thing to do. But actually, there's something very profound in it, which I think speaks to our situation here. I was reading recently a book by Søren Kierkegaard, the Danish philosopher, Christian philosopher. It's a book called The Works of Love. It's a remarkable book. And in it, he argues that the highest form of love is not what we think it is. In our culture, we tend to think the highest form of love is maybe romantic love, you know, finding the one person you're destined to spend your life with. Or we might think it's family love for your children, love for your parents. Or we might think it's love for your tribe, or your family, or some people you're close to. Those are the kinds of love we value most in our society. And Kierkegaard argues actually the highest form of Christian love for the Christian, the highest form of love for the Christian is not erotic love, it's not romantic love, it's not friendship love, it's not family love, it's neighbor love. Love for your neighbor. In other words, love not for the person that you've chosen to love because they are likable, because you've been in love with them, or because they're related to you, but it's love for the person that God places next to you, whether you like them or not. And whatever background and ethnicity and gender and sexuality and religion they may be, that's the person you're called to love, your neighbor. And the reason he says that's the highest form of love is because that's most like God's love. Because God's love is not selective. He doesn't just choose some people to love and not others. His love is the same for everyone. And so therefore, if our love is to be like God's love, it has to be neighbor love. And that's a higher form of love than any romantic love or friendship love or family love. That's a remarkable thing that he says. In fact, Kierkegaard, there's this, Christianity has thrust erotic love and friendship from the throne, the love rooted in mood and inclination, preferential love, in order to establish spiritual love in its place, love to one's neighbour. And what that says to us, it seems to me in our culture, is really countercultural. It says us that we are called to love our neighbour, not just our families and our friends and our spouses and those people who are part of our group. We are called to love our neighbour. That's the highest calling on any human being, is to learn to love your neighbour. And usually your neighbour is not someone you chose. We choose our spouses, we choose our friends, we don't always choose our family, we can stuck with them. But our neighbours we do not choose. But when Jesus says we are to learn to love, it's that person with all their awkwardness and difficulty that we're called to love. The other thing is we're called to love our neighbour, we're called to love our neighbour. In other words, not just to tolerate them, not even just to respect them, but to love them. And to love means not just to acknowledge their existence and not to do them any harm, it's actively to seek their welfare. How do I seek the welfare of my neighbour? How do I do what it takes to make their life better? Now it strikes me that Grenfell was an example of our failure to love our neighbour. And the blame game is all around here. People blame RBKC, they blame the government, they may be blamed to be a candidate, they may blame all kinds of people at TMO, and that may be right. But I think it's a dangerous thing to start blaming individual groups and people. This is something for all of us. Because actually, in areas like that, in North Kensington, we are allowed to simply just drift. And that sense of neglect is something that we're all complicit in. So that sense of the failure to love our neighbour, the failure to listen to the cries of our neighbour, the people who are saying this place is unsafe, it's not a good place to live, we are feeling abandoned, we are feeling not cared for. We fail to listen to those voices. And therefore, Grenfell, I think, is a call to us to rediscover this absolutely central question to love our neighbour. Of course, the question then comes, who is my neighbour? That's what the man asks in the story. And the story of the Good Samaritan suggests to us it's actually that the neighbour is the person who is placed in front of you who needs your help, whatever they are, whatever background they might be. And that's where the Samaritan aspect comes in, because the Samaritan, of course, was the last person that a Jew would expect to help him on the side of the road. In fact, Jesus, at the end of the story, turns it around a little bit. Who was a neighbor to the man who was lying there? And the question he asks, I think, of those of us listening to the story is, who are you called to be a neighbor to? So it's not just who is my neighbor, but who am I called to be a neighbor to? So that question of who is my neighbor is a crucial one. The third thing, I want to talk about, let's just go on here a minute, is that you read in these stories this deeply costly compassion. That actually loving the neighbor is a deeply costly thing. You can't do it in just spare moments. When you read the story of the Good Samaritan, you read this. And he went to him and bandaged his wounds, and he poured oil and wine on them. He put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper and said, take care of him. When I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend. There's a kind of open-ended, costly generosity in this action. And if we are to really engage with communities like North Kensington, if we are to bring a measure of justice to this, if we are to learn to love our neighbour, and to love our neighbour, that is going to be costly compassion. It's going to cost us as a society. It's going to mean perhaps some sacrifices for us. It's actually going to mean that we're not going to be able to have all the prosperity that we need, or we think we need. And it strikes me that there's a kind of fundamental cultural change we need here in our society. Because there is much in our society that actually militates against this. And there was a book that came out a little while ago, some of you may have seen it, called Selfie: How We Became So Self-Obsessed and What It's Doing to Us, by this man, Will Storr. It's a fascinating book that says, you know, we've been captured by the self-esteem industry. And there was a kind of psychology that told us that all our problems basically come from low self-esteem. And therefore, what you have to do is boost your self-esteem by telling yourself how wonderful you are. So we have a generation of people, the children coming up, have always been told they're wonderful, they're amazing, they can change the world, they're fantastic people. Of course, they start believing in it. They don't see the flaws within themselves at the same time. And there's a sense of entitlement, that sense of we've got everything we possibly need. And perhaps we are living in one of the most self-obsessed cultures that there has ever been. We can't take pictures of buildings anymore without taking ourselves in at the same time. Now, again, there's arguments on either side to this, but the analysis that he makes in this book is really of a culture that is obsessed with the self, how we present ourselves on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram or whatever else it might be, the image that we project to the wider world. How am I getting on? How is my personal prosperity? And actually, to learn to love the neighbour is actually to turn yourself outwards from that. A fundamental shift of mind, a conversion. That's what it really is. It's as deep as that. It's a conversion of life and heart and mind. So that we become less obsessed with ourselves and instead turned outwards towards God and other people. Martin Luther, who would have been the topic of this, coming in a bit somewhere, gives a definition of sin. And he says, sin is to be curved in upon yourself. To be so obsessed with yourself you cannot think of anybody else besides yourself. And occasionally you meet people like that who just cannot think of anyone else but themselves, that sort of narcissistic view. But all of us have a bit of it. And what he says is that the grace of God, what the grace of God does is to turn us outwards from ourselves towards God and towards other people. We begin to forget ourselves, we become less self-conscious, less self-obsessed. And experience that conversion of life to begin to love our neighbour, to be actively concerned for the welfare of our neighbour, not just our own. So, costly compassion that is part of this story. The other thing, just two things to mention before we finish. We need to see our neighbours as a gift and not a threat. There seems to be a lot in our culture encourages us to see our neighbours as a threat. Take, for example, our view of freedom. We tend to think in our society that freedom is freedom to do what I want with my time, my goods, my money, my possessions, as long as I don't tread on the toes of anybody else's freedom. That's how we understand freedom, isn't it? Freedom is freedom to do what I like as long as I don't infringe on anybody else's freedom. The problem with that, it seems to me, is that if that's the way we understand freedom, then my neighbour becomes at best a limitation, at worst a threat to my freedom. They provide a barrier. And they say, well, I'd like to be with my car because my neighbour's in the way. Or actually, that person might actually infringe on my freedom. And it sets up relationships of opposition, fear, and conflict, which I think is why we have so much sort of polarisation and conflict in our society. Instead, if you take a view of freedom as being what I think a Christian understands freedom is to be, freedom from everything that would stop me becoming the person that God created me to be, in other words, someone capable of love for God and love for my neighbour, in other words, freedom from those emotions, habits of life, pride, envy, lust, gluttony, all those things that would make me turn in on myself, and jealousy and so on, freedom from all of those, freedom from an economic system that is constantly telling me that I cannot be fully myself, I cannot be everything that I want to be if I don't have this type of clothing and that kind of car and that kind of computer. It's freedom to be someone capable of loving God and your neighbour. If you understand freedom like that, then your neighbour becomes a gift and not a threat. Because if I'm to learn to love my neighbour, I need someone to practice on. My neighbour is someone to help me to learn to become the person that God made me to be. Now the paradox of this, this costly compassion, this viewing the neighbour as a gift and a threat, is actually, this is actually what makes us happy, what makes society work. See our neighbours as gifts to be loved, not threats to be feared, is actually to create a society where everyone is looking out for everyone else's interests. You don't have to worry about your own interests because your neighbour's looking out for yours. They don't have to look out for their interests because you're looking out for them. You can begin to see how there's a kind of social dynamic there which is much healthier than the way we often think of it in our society. Then, lastly, it seems to me that this is calling for a view of generosity rather than austerity. Now that is not particularly a comment on economic systems, but it's talking about our attitudes towards each other. Not that austerity that says, well, I have to keep what we have, keep it to myself, make sure that I can somehow survive through this. But instead that generosity of spirit that wants to see how I can give in a costly, sacrificial way to others who are around me. So, excuse me, these are some of the themes that comes out from a reflection on the story of the Good Samaritan in the light of Grenfell Tower. I think this calls for a deep conversion of ourselves as individuals, but ourselves more widely as a culture and a society. A different view of freedom, a different view of our resources and how we use them, a different view of ourselves and our relations with one another. And if we can learn some of these lessons, then maybe the Grenfell might just be that spark that causes us to relate to each other in a much more healthy, constructive, and just way than we've done in the past. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bishop. You're ready to take some questions, I gather.
Very happy to,
yeah. So, Chairman Simon with the roaming mic is going to come and find your questions.
So, if you have a question, just do put your hands in the air. I'm very happy to answer what I can about everything I've said, but also about other things to do with the current situation as well. So, yeah.
Anybody going past Latin Road Station can't fail to notice a memorial to Mellitus, there. Is that evidence of an underlying anger?
Yep. Did everyone hear that question?
No.
The question was whenever you go near a Latin Road tube station, when you go near many of the sites around some of the churches, you see placards, you see at the time there were a lot of it was like shrines that emerged with letters and prayers and teddy bears and flowers and signs on the railings outside churches or near the tube station and so on. The question is that a manifestation of anger? Some of it is. Some of it's a manifestation of grief. Grief is something that goes on for a long, long time, especially when it's traumatic grief like this. You never get closure on grief. And so some of it's an expression of grief, some of it is an expression of anger. And anger is always a two-edged thing. And one of the things that I think within the Christian scriptures is that little phrase, you know, do not let the sun go down on your anger, which is saying you don't want to live with anger for too long. It's not good for a person to hold anger within themselves. And that's one of the things I think we need to... anger is justified within this context, it seems to me. There was a lot of justified anger, but anger is not a thing you can live with for the whole of your life. And so there is anger in it, there's still anger in it, there's still frustration with the way in which the local community, the survivors and bereaved have been treated, not just at the time, but before, even since then as well. We're still in a situation where out of 200 families or households that have been made homeless by the fire, only around 60 are now in permanent housing. So two-thirds of the families still not in some of the temporary housing, some of them in emergency accommodations for the hotels. So you can understand why the anger is there. And some of the ways in which that's been handled has not actually been ideal at all. So I think the anger is still there. It hasn't gone away, maybe not quite as visceral as it was, but it's still there.
We've lived pretty close to Grenfell for the last half century. One of the things immediately post Grenfell was this outpouring of, I think, what was neighbourly love from all parts of society. The other thing that happened, of course, was that all the different faiths came together to work together focused on support and so on. I would like to know whether you feel that cooperation, collaboration between the faiths can be continued as Grenfell becomes past history.
Sure. Do I hear that question? Yes, I mean, you're right, it was just for those couple of days, there was this explosion of real neighbourly love. It was extraordinary seeing it happen. But then we go back to normal again, don't we? And you kind of think, not entirely, but much of London returned to its normal kind of way of life. And I think what that gave you a glimpse of is what would London be like if it was like that all the time? And where people were genuinely looking out for their neighbours, just not thinking about themselves, just doing what people did in those 2 days. In terms of the faith working together, at the end, that was a very strong aspect of it, of the response at the time. There were quite a number of kind of interfaith vigils that took place around the time of the tower, the fire. I mean, one reflection I had on that is that sometimes within the multi-faith vigils, one of the questions was, you know, who convenes those? Who sort of takes charge of them? And at the time, very often what happened actually was that it was the government department that took upon itself to organize that. So it was almost the state managing religion. I'm a little bit uncomfortable about that process, which is partly why with the service we wanted to say, actually, no, this is not the state doing this. We want to do this ourselves as the faith together. Certainly, the relationships between the different faiths in the local area, one of the good things to come out of this has been strengthening relationships between them. There was, I think, an interfaith group in the local area, but I think it had rather fallen into disuse in recent times. And many of the faiths did come together. We got to know the people at Al Mosque really, really well. And they've had a huge admiration for what they've done. They've been fantastic in the way they've supported the local community as well. So I think it has created that. We're beginning to think about what happens at the 12-month anniversary in June of this year. And that's something which I think all the faiths will be involved in. It has to be, because it is a multi-faith area. It's an area where many faiths are represented, particularly in the local area, predominantly. Very strong Muslim presence, very strong Christian presence as well, not necessarily Anglican, often different Christian denominations from around the world. Other churches are there as well. Those are the predominant faiths that are there. There's also Sikh and Hindu and Jewish groups a bit further away. So my hope is very much that can happen, because it seems to me that faiths can cooperate in all kinds of areas where there is common concern, and we all share that same concern for the community. Very much so that is going to continue, and the conversation, the relationships that it's formed have been much stronger now than they were before.
I was just wondering whether in the sort of social sense of neighbourhoods and neighbourliness, in the past it would be, you know, shared activities that would bring people together there, and then essentially the option at any rate of intermarriage or, you know, marrying your neighbour, and that would then create that sort of affinity and sense of cohesion. We've lost a lot of, you know, those corporate activities which provided that sense of affinity and neighbourliness and neighbourliness. You know, if you take something like, say, Remembrance Day services 30, 40, 50 years ago, those would have provided that sort of sense of cohesion. There are things that do that now, that on the Hill Carnival, I suppose. You know, you could be seen as one at Glastonbury, I'm sure lots of people feel there is a neighbourly there and do afterwards. And in a sense, you know, a tragedy like Grenfell Tower does bring everybody together, it does create that sense of community, but it's just one tragic act. So, from a social point of view, as opposed to a, if I can put it what you're talking about, a theological point of view, the trick is to find ways in which we have shared activities which create a genuine social sense of neighbourliness and neighbourhood.
Yeah, thank you. I think, you're right, a tragedy does bring people together, it did at the time. It also, in the longer term, breaks people apart as well. We've seen a sort of fracturing of the community in many ways, which is a very common pattern. Potentially talking to Bishop James Jones in Hillsborough after what exactly the same is that you should expect that groups will splinter and one group won't get on with another group and one group won't talk to another. That's often what happens when you get trauma. So yes, you get a coming together, but also it's not all coming together. It's also a fracturing that happens at the same time. Those joint activities, you're right, you get big events like running in Carnival or Glastonbury or whatever it might be, or even as a full service, but I think we need more local events, more regular ones. And that's why I think actually communities like churches, faith communities, become really quite important, because they're one of the few places where different people from different backgrounds do come together. I remember being at St. Clement's Church on the Sunday after the fire where and St. Clement's is not a big church, it's not a sort of huge, big, mega church, but anyway, even if it's at all, it's quite a small church. But in that building, there was this, again, extraordinary mix of people, all kinds of different ages and backgrounds and ethnicities, and all come together in this space. And I was thinking, well, where else would you get this mix of people in our society? Obviously, churches and I don't have the social links that they used to, for all kinds of reasons. But one of the ironies out of this, I think, was that it was at the time when the churches, the mosques, community centres were the places that people flocked to, rather than the kind of official set-up places that were laid out by the council, because they were trusted within the local community. One of the ironies is sometimes churches and religious groups can't get funding because the line is, well, you're religious, you know, you're partial, you're kind of restrictive. That we can't fund you, we will only fund secular groups that don't have any commitments. Well, actually, it was the religious groups that were trusted, not the council or the government. And so there's an argument to say actually, the religious groups that have a strong sense of their own identity do deserve actually public funding, rather than saying that they shouldn't because they're faith specific. So I do think there's a real role there for local community groups to create joint action for churches. But only churches that look outwards, churches that look inwards to their own community never do it. But the more churches are able to put on things that involve local people, gathering crowd, let's do stuff together, they are well placed to do that in a world where we are more and more atomized, more and more set, cut off from one another in this very kind of, you know, self-absorbed culture.
Hi there, I went to the vigil a week after in Parliament Square, and you talked about the mistrust of political institutions, but there were a lot of young people there talking about how they hadn't voted, they hadn't been interested in politics. Also, you know, you've got to do something, you've got to engage. I just wondered if you could say or know anything more about that.
Yeah, it's an interesting phenomenon. It has galvanised interest in the kind of political issues around Grenfell, about how we do social housing, how we treat more disadvantaged. So there is this strange paradox of a kind of lack of trust of government, and yet suddenly an interest in it. Now, I don't doubt how hard government is. I do think that RBKC and government have made mistakes in the way that it has been handled. I think there is a right sort of frustration and a certain degree of anger with the way that's happened. I think they're trying to do better at it. And I see two things going on at the moment. I actually see a bit of a sort of a really interesting tussle going on between the way in which the politics is working. Now, on the one hand, you see some really good signs. So, for example, the decision recently to put the future of the site of Grenfell entirely in the hands of both the museum, especially the bereaved, and saying that RBKC has no interest at all, no plans at all for the site. That seems to be a really good thing. It was, in a sense, RBKC learning to realise actually government is not about imposing solutions upon people, it's about enabling people to find their own solutions for things that affect them. That was a really good thing. The Ideas Day for Lancaster West Estate, where it was Lancaster West, the suspicion was always that the real desire is to kind of knock it down and build some smart houses which we can sell off to developers. And the local community is now, in some ways, empowered to be able to say, no, we don't want to be knocked down. We want the place to be made better. And so, in terms of plans for that, again, the council has committed itself to being very, very consultative and in a genuine way, not just consulting with a plan in mind, but with architects coming in working with the local community. So, those are some of the good things that have happened. On the other hand, I think there are lots of good things that have happened. When you talk to many of the families who are still waiting to be rehoused, the decision of the council to buy a block of 300 houses or properties and then say, here you are, take the pick. That, and a lot of those properties often are felt to be quite a lot smaller than what they had. Not a great condition, many of them still without gas and electricity or gas and fire checks. You can understand many of those families feeling, well, why are you just giving us properties, not giving us a choice in that? Seems to me it would have been a much better way to actually provide each family with a caseworker and just to say, look, let's help you find a house where it really is, rather than buying it for us and just giving you us a limited choice. So it seems to me there are examples of good practice emerging, of genuine engagement with local community. There are examples still of that slightly patronising, you know, here's the solution, we're doing it for you. Now those issues are really galvanised people in terms of politics, and so I can see why there's a distrust, but also an interest in getting involved in local politics from that point of view. But again, I'm always wary of trying to allocate blame to one group or another. It's too easy sometimes to do that. I think RBKC are in a very difficult position trying to work out what to do in this situation. That doesn't absolve them from what some of the decisions have been taking place. But I think that politics is basically about the life of the city. Politics is about the life of the polis, the city. And we live in a city. We live together. It's about how we live together. That's what politics is. And to that extent, we all need to be interested in politics, how we live together, how our life is organised. And the division between sort of spiritual and political is a slightly artificial one. I mean, I've been talking mainly today about what I'm calling the sort of theological and spiritual angles to that. But I don't want to divide that too closely, too far from the political angle, because it seems to me that they are both very closely related to each other. They're about how we live together. I think separating out the political and the spiritual is always a bit of a mistake for either side, either from Christians who want to be able to do politics or politicians who think there's no spiritual dimension to this at all.
Of course, I and my friend behind me have both worked in BBC 24 Hour News,
yeah.
And I'm just curious, with hindsight, what one thing would you wish the media had done differently?
Yeah, good question. There was a lot of local anger about the media. I remember on the Saturday after the fire, giving a series of interviews quite near the sites, and one of them we could not finish the interview because somebody locally was just shouting at the media saying, go away, we don't want you here, you're just invading our grief, you know, sort of voyeuristic, looking into and feeding off the Greek people locally, which was not really very helpful. I think some of the intrusiveness of the media, that's probably the thing I'd say I wish hadn't happened. There were a number of families who did feel that, you know, kinds of slight shady tricks were used to get stories found, posing as just friends or volunteers, actually they were. And also I think the sort of slightly sensationalist side of it. I talked to one guy who got out of the fire, who gave an interview to the media and spoke for quite a long time about some of these issues that we're talking about today, some of the kind of spiritual political issues arising out of it. There was one moment where he was with a friend and he broke down in tears and embraced his friend as part of that. And they played back the interview on TV, you can guess which bit they focused on. It was the bit of the emotion when he broke down. Actually, the kind of quite cogent argument he made about the political ramifications of that was entirely ignored. So that slightly sensationalist, emotionally focused strand of media really was not helpful in that context. So I think those are some of the things I'd say. That the media just need to be kind of aware of the reasons. Some of them were very good at that. Some of them recognised where they were overstepping the marks and stepped back from that, and all of them did. So that willingness not to be intrusive into the Greek people, but also not over-evoking, you know. Again, that's the same as also, I mean, taking advantage of the Greek people rather than actually trying to listen to the arguments. Okay.
Just picking up on the point you made about intrusion, like you, I was involved in Grenfell in the immediate aftermath. Part of my experience was an awful lot of people came into the mostly with good motives, but wanted to take over the situation and I think the community that they were being invaded. And what do you think we might learn from that? Does perhaps loving your neighbour sometimes involve a bit of restraint, possibly?
Yeah, that's a really good point. Yeah, you're absolutely right. Out of very good motives, just about every relief organisation in the world suddenly thought, oh, we need to go and do something dreadful. And you saw people with all kinds of t-shirts and bags and every organisation you think were all crowding around. I think there were about 600 organisations at one point involved in offering some kind of help, whether mental health issues or practical help or art therapy or whatever it might be. Everybody was trying to help. And everyone says that's a good thing. You know, it's good that people offer to help. But I think, as you say, a lot of it was, we've got the solution, here it is, we deliver it to you. And what that does is actually disempower people. Because it doesn't give them any responsibility for actually creating their own solutions to what is needed. Because the people who know what it's like on the ground, they need to do that. And sort of pre-packaged solutions delivered from on high, from this group or that group, doesn't always help. Because it did feel like a lot of groups coming in and sort of imposing what they had to do. Always in the language of it, we're offering this to the local community, but it didn't always help. And some of the most effective things have been where actually people have come alongside with the local community and said, how can we help you find the best way forward? We tried to do that a bit with the service of St Paul's, because we realised when we started out doing that, it would be very easy for us as the religious professionals to come in and put together a service and deliver it for the people of North Kensington. And we kind of realised right from the beginning that was not going to work. So we said to St Paul's Cathedral that what we need to do is set up a series of meetings between St Paul's people and local groups, where we just to listen really carefully and think, what do you want to come out of this service? What do you want it to be? How do you want, what's the feel you want within that? So it's something that does genuinely arise from the community. So I think there is proper restraint, and it's, there can be a little bit of it. Grenfell's a big thing, everyone's talking about, so we want to be seen in there. There is a proper restraint in working out where you can and can't help, recognising where actually you're delivering something pre-packaged, which is really not helping the local community itself to heal. And part of the healing is finding dignity, I think. The community that was largely did not feel treated with dignity, and part of the healing, I think, is for that community to feel, yeah, we can craft our own future with the help of others. And so I think you're absolutely right. There is a degree of restraint, there's a degree of to what extent are you willing to put in the long-term costly compassion of working with people, sometimes working with their anger, sometimes working with their frustration, sticking with it, not running away when that happens. Because if you dip your toe in the Grenfell world, you will get anger, you will get frustration, you will get all those sort of powerful emotions, and you're going to have to stick with that at the same time. One more then? One last question, good time for it.
Bishop Gray, thank you. I was just wondering, how has this affected your understanding of your role as a bishop when you come across a situation like this and impact you and your oversight over your Episcopal area? Reflect on that.
Yeah, thank you. I suppose everyone hear that question? I guess in a number of ways. I think it's obviously the part of my role is to support churches. It's always the most important people there, Christian terms, not me, it was the local clergy who had built up trust over a long period of time, the local churches that had done that, and my role was just to come and support them, and in some ways to be the public face for them, in a way that I could do the interviews while they were busy doing the kind of real work. So being that sort of public face representing church, I guess that's what you sort of do as an ordained person is, if some clergy person is, there's someone who kind of represents the church publicly, and you try to do that as well as you possibly can. And obviously, as a bishop, you do that on a kind of wider scale. I think the other thing is the kind of convening power that you have. On a number of occasions, I felt I was able to bring together the local faith leaders and parts of the community that it was quite hard for others to do. And the service, for example, in support, I remember the Methodist minister, Mike Long, was very involved in. Which was right from the beginning, saying to me at one point, so you do realise that you're the only people who can do this, by which he meant not Anglicans. Because he said, well, you are the established church, we couldn't do it, the Methodists, the Muslims couldn't do it, the Baptists couldn't do it. You are the established church, you have St. Paul's Cathedral, you have these amazing buildings, you are better or worse, well, not the reason, my interpretation. We are the people who can do that. Because of our history, because in a sense, we as the Anglican Church have both our kind of feet on the ground in local parishes. So, we as the Anglican Church were trusted locally because St. Clement's has got 150 years of community involvement and so on. But we also, we know government enough for the Prime Minister's faith representative to give me a call because he knows me a little bit. And so, because we have that range, we're not the council, we're not the government, we are linked to local community, but we kind of can play that role in between all to convene and bring people together. And so I guess those are sort of my reflections on the role of bishop in this, which is both oversight but also speaking on behalf of. And there are times I think where I have the opportunity to, I don't speak for any, I don't speak for the local community, I don't live there. But listening to people in the local community, sometimes there's an opportunity to say things to the media to try to represent what people were feeling locally, which was able to communicate to the wider world. I remember one interview with a radio journalist who was trying to, her goal was to try to communicate to the rest of the country what North Kensington is like. And we spent about half an hour wandering around the streets around North Kensington and describing what we were seeing. And of course, you can go in a few minutes from social housing, tower blocks, to 5 million, 10 million pound houses just around the corner on the edge of the hill. You can walk from street to street and you just see these extremes of wealth, poverty, advantages, disadvantages, and so on. Just trying to communicate that. So I thought that again, that's something I could do as a bishop of the local area, bringing a wider picture to that. And,
we must finish. Thank you very much. Before I ask you to give Bishop Graham a round of applause, can I wait? I just wanted to remind you that we've got Matthew Price from the BBC talking on Brief Encounters on the Refugee Trail, not the first Wednesday, but the second Wednesday, April Wednesday the 18th. And there's rather a nice link, I think, between patronising disposition and working with refugees, and perhaps I'll ask him about that as we sort of begin. So please, once again, the 18th, and as you know, we've got to Chaparabuna coming on Wednesday the 9th of May as our final lecture. Can I again thank our sponsor, Finley Brewer, for supporting us and publishing all the leaflets and things like that. Thank you very much for that. But again, it was fantastic. Thank you very much. Please give the Bishop a round of applause.